Item number, SCP-130. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-130 is to be staffed by 12 D-class, 6 security agents, level 2/130, and 1 researcher, level 3/130, twice per day, starting at 1/2 hour before local sunrise and sunset. All staff are to be appropriately uniformed. When not staffed, 2 security agents will remain in the lobby, and 2 additional agents will patrol within the building. Agents are advised not to prevent people from entering the lobby, but to notify MTF Alpha 4, Pony Express, to intercept anyone who receives mail or a package. Twice per day, bundles, SCP-132, will appear in the mail room. The parcels within the bundles are to be sorted by uniformed staff into appropriate bags and placed in a designated vehicle for transport to site. Should mail arrive with the following addresses, follow procedure Franklin 16, detailed in Addendum 132. Otherwise, mail will be checked under standard practices for any items of interest. Objects are not to be placed for outgoing mail unless certified orders are given by O5. Procedure Franklin 17 outlines the protocol used in these cases. Should anyone else enter SCP-130 to use the outgoing mail slot, they are to be permitted to do so, then intercepted by MTF Alpha 4 as soon as possible for questioning. The incident is to be reviewed through security tapes, and the outgoing mail watched for subsequent bundles and checked through the list of previous parcels received. Description: SCP-130 is a post office in an undisclosed location in South Africa, constructed in 18... SCP-130 had been closed and left abandoned for a number of years. The building is in excellent condition for its age, and maintains itself without human intervention, including moderate structural repairs. SCP-130 has been designated a historic site through an agreement with the South African government. 5 times per week at local sunrise and sunset, several bags and boxes will appear in the mailroom. The bundles, designated SCP-132, will show only on weekdays, with the exception of current postal holidays. Bundles are to be handled as per special containment procedures as above. Inside of the lobby, along with the post office boxes, is a slot labeled for outgoing mail. The slot is able to accept packages up to 40 centimeters wide and 6 centimeters high, with no apparent limit for length. Once inserted into the slot, packages disappear, and will eventually turn up in the outgoing mail bundles, if they have not done so previously. Addendum 131. SCP-130 came to the attention of the Foundation in 19... when packages and letters began to be circulated bearing the postmark for the site. The parcels appeared in post offices throughout the world with correct postage for delivery either locally or internationally, depending on the parcel. The parcels were often undeliverable, either to non-existent addresses, or to recipients who were not at the address, and so ended up in dead letter offices. Various Foundation assets noted the odd postmark, and Mobile Task Force Alpha 4 mobilized to investigate. MTF Alpha 4 arrived in where they discovered the town had mostly been abandoned decades ago. The post office appeared to be in excellent condition, not only well-maintained, but clean. While MTF Alpha 4 searched, bundles of mail appeared in the mailroom. Agents searched the bundles and discovered a variety of letters, parcels, and packages, all with that day's date and the postmark for that post office. A Foundation agent attempted to open one of the parcels, which resulted in the agent vanishing from sight. 6 days later, a package appeared in sight's mailroom. Inside of it was said agent, and an envelope with a receipt for postage due. The agent had "return to sender" and "postage due" tattooed on their back, and was in a comatose state. Agent remained in that state until the envelope was delivered to SCP-130's outgoing mail slot, whereupon the agent returned to consciousness, with no recollection from the time of disappearance. Similar results also occurred when agents tried to take away or damage either the parcels or the post office itself. Further investigation led to the current containment procedures, where D-class personnel sort through the mail when it appears. Once processed and put in a marked vehicle, the mail can then leave the area unmolested. If the bundles are untouched, however, the bundles will vanish and later appear in the postal systems of the world, in order to be delivered. Addendum 132. Through examination of the mail parcels over the past several years, research has shown certain trends. Over 1% of the mail is of a mundane nature, except for the matter of the postmark. Exceptions to this are letters that were apparently unsent, for whatever reason, and temporally displaced letters. The former, while odd, will be destroyed in order to protect the nature of SCP-130. Letters addressed to Foundation sites or personnel are to be sent to site where they will be reviewed. Procedure Franklin 16. When mail is specifically addressed, the mail is to be sealed in a case with active countermeasures and brought to the office of the present level 5/130 supervisor. Mail will then be screened for possible explosive, chemical, biological, mimetic, or any and all threats. After screening, the mail will be opened and assessed. While no new artifacts requiring secure containment have arrived, the possibility cannot be ignored. Mail either addressed to or intercepted by the office is often temporally sensitive, and as such, impact must be minimized to limit changes. The possibility of the information being used to alter present-day events detrimentally must also be weighed. Using the information given by SCP-130 to alter events requires a two-thirds supermajority vote by the overseers. Examples of intercepted messages are stored within Document 131. Mail with the following code phrase are to be immediately delivered after screening, without being read by 5/130. After so doing, that code phrase is to be invalidated, and the next one brought in line. Procedure Franklin 17. All outgoing mail is to be sent with appropriate current postage at the time of sending, and must be marked with a suitable code phrase. The mail sent by this method is to be logged, then cross-checked with past parcels, to ensure temporal integrity. Upon attempt at mailing, should a receipt appear for postage due, the amount shall be placed in an envelope and put in the outgoing mail slot. The slot will accept the following currencies: rands, euros, and the use of counterfeit currencies will result in a lethal reaction by SCP-130, and an additional fine will be levied until mail can be sent again. Addendum 133. Incident 136. On a package arrived, with the address for a post office box at the site. Dr. the researcher assigned to SCP-130, placed the parcel into the POB and waited. Several minutes later, an unknown person walked into the lobby. The subject appeared to be briefly puzzled and walked over to the box. The locked box opened at his touch, and he expressed surprise at seeing the parcel with his name on it. MTF Alpha 4, being on site, was dispatched to investigate once the subject was out of sight of SCP-130 and subsequently interviewed. The subject had no plans to visit that day, but had felt an unexplained desire to go there while driving nearby to visit family in the area. Upon opening the package, data expunged. A Class A amnestic was administered to the subject and was released after memory insertion. Document 131. Executive Summary of Instances, SCP-132. To this date, there have been several instances of SCP-132 that fall under Procedure Franklin 16, and with certain exceptions, all have been reviewed by this office. Below are brief summaries of sampled parcels addressed to persons of note, both within and outside of the Foundation. Dr. M.E., 5/130. Addressee, Dr. Alto Clef. Summary. To this date, Dr. Clef has had several parcels addressed to him in a variety of fashions, up to using valid code phrases per Procedure Franklin 16. In each and every case, these parcels have contained a wide variety of means to assassinate the good doctor, tied with either gloating, terse judgments, or even apologies. Notes. After many deaths and dollars worth of damage to Foundation material, all missives addressed to Dr. Clef are to be thoroughly scanned and opened by remote under Hazmat 3 conditions. Due to the incident on only D-class personnel should handle the mail and be within 50 meters until disposed of. Addressee, Dr. Agatha Wrights. Summary. Dr. Wrights has had a variety of greeting cards sent to her, denoting such things as birthdays, anniversaries, and holidays such as Mother's Day from undisclosed recipients. Notes. Due to all such parcels are to be incinerated, and under no circumstances are they to be mentioned to Dr. Wrights. Addressee, Dr. King. Summary. Each Arbor Day for the past several years, a variety of apple-based products have been mailed to Dr. King, including seeds, cider, and brandy. Every September 26th, a biography of John Chapman, aka Johnny Appleseed, has appeared. Notes. Christ, what did this guy do to SCP-130? I don't even think he's been to South Africa. 5/130. Lesson complete. If you missed the previous orientation, go watch SCP-129, Progressive Fungal Infection, right now. Or for the complete course, watch this playlist.